Former Acting Attorney General Sally Yates has given her first TV interview, and it was to CNN, to Anderson Cooper. This is obviously since being fired by President Trump, and more importantly, since giving that very important testimony. So the full interview is going to air tonight on AC360. Yates answers tough questions from Coop about former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn, about the chain of events, about her tone and her intentions, and how the White House took her message. So all of this is relevant, especially right now. Here's a preview.
The underlying conduct itself was potentially a fireable offense.
You know, I can't speak to a fireable offense. It was up to the president to make that decision about what he was going to do. But we certainly felt like they needed to act.
Don McGahn actually asked you at that first meeting whether or not you thought the National Security Advisor should be fired.
Mm-hmm.
What did you say?
I told him it wasn't our call.
Was the underlying conduct illegal? Was it illegality involved?
There's certainly a criminal statute that was implicated by his conduct.
You wanted the White House to act?
Absolutely, yes.
To do something?
We expected the White House to act.
Did you expect them to act quickly?
Yes.
There was urgency to the information?
Yes.
I'm just wondering, just on a personal level, and I don't know if you can answer this or not, but, you know, you're in government 1 week, you get fired, and now you're out, and you're watching day after day after day go by, and nothing seems to have happened to the National Security Advisor that you have informed the White House about. Just as a private citizen at that point, did it concern you?
Well, sure, I was concerned about it. But I didn't know if perhaps something else had been done that maybe I just wasn't aware of.
Maybe that they were keeping him away from certain classified information while they were investigating, something like that.
Maybe. I just didn't have any way of knowing what was going on at that point.
Were you aware that he sat in on even from media reports, that he sat in on a phone call with Russia's president?
Just from media
reports.
Between
the president and Russia's mm-hmm. president. Did you find that surprising?
Well, sure. Absolutely, that was surprising.
Sean Spicer said on the day after Michael Flynn resigned that it was a trust issue that led to his resignation, not a legal issue. Do you agree there was no legal issue with Flynn's underlying behavior?
I don't know how the White House reached the conclusion that there was no legal issue. It certainly wasn't from my discussion with them.
Do you think Michael Flynn should have been fired?
I think that this was a serious compromise situation, that the Russians had real leverage. He also had lied to the Vice President of the United States. You know, whether he's fired or not is a decision for the President of the United States to make, but doesn't seem like that's a person who should be sitting in the National Security Advisor position.
Michael Flynn was let go after the Washington Post reported a story. Some Republicans have accused you of leaking it. Did you leak to the Washington Post?
Absolutely not.
Did you authorize somebody to leak to the Washington
Absolutely
Post?
Absolutely not. I did not, and I would not leak classified information.
Have you ever leaked information to them?
No.
The president seems to suggest that you were behind this Washington Post order. The morning before you testified, he tweeted, "Ask Sally Yates under oath if she knows how classified information got into newspapers soon after she explained it to White House counsel."
Mm-hmm.
It does sound like he doesn't, he seems to believe that you're the leaker. Does that, when you heard that, what'd you think?
Well, there have been a number of tweets that have given me pause.
You want to elaborate on that?
No.
All right, let's bring our panel back. Ron Brownstein, David Sanger, and Philip Mudd. Ron Brownstein, reaction.
Yeah, I think it was the last one especially. You know, that's very powerful testimony, and the, you know, the question the White House has never sufficiently answered is of why it took so long to act after the warning that the acting attorney general provided, and of course the action only came after the underlying question was revealed in the Washington Post. It really goes back, I think, Chris, to this core issue, and we've talked about this before, on Election Day. Between a fifth and a quarter of the people who voted for Donald Trump said they were uncertain of the temperament or the qualifications to serve as president. They wanted change. They were willing to take a chance. But certainly what has happened over these, you know, 3.5, 4 months has tended more to reconfirm than to dissolve those doubts. And I think it just sharpens the question on the place where there is the most leverage, which is the congressional Republicans, who have by and large chosen to lock arms around him to emphasize the areas of their agenda when they agree, and not really to exercise a lot of oversight or outside pressure to kind of clean up this act. And I think that question will loom larger as they go forward. Is that ultimately in their political interest to remain kind of lockstep behind him, or do they ultimately need to prove to a country that is at best ambivalent about this president that they are providing some check, some boundary, and some limits on the aspects of his behavior that concern many Americans?
Poppy, if you're going to take your signal from the top, McConnell, Ryan,
totally
quiet, and when they do come out, they seem to be nothing but accommodative, which is their choice,
but it is
sending
it
a message.
Different this time. I mean, you look at our reporter Chris Saliz's column this morning. The headline is, you know, is this the straw that broke the camel's back? Is this going to be different? We're going to have him on in a bit to talk about it. But Phil Mudd, I just want to circle